Between them have over 50 years of experience as teachers, social workers, and administrators. They both have been administrators in high school where their graduation rate has been 98% or higher. And the reason that you have success like that is because of the educational team that you're able to form, develop. And you're able to develop a good educational team because you have a good evaluation process in place to make sure that your teachers, your staff are headed in the right direction and are doing what they need to do. And as we know, teacher evaluation is one of the items that are out there now. So they're going to be talking to you about the nuts and bolts of teacher evaluation.
Thank you.
Anybody, Glenn pointed out the obvious to me when he started to say, oh, this is a tough act to follow. And that is pretty obvious. I did appreciate that. I was thinking the whole time, geez, we've got to follow that dynamic. And I would have canceled the videos. It was a good challenge. And I looked around the room and I'm going to tell a little history of what is an evaluation. And I had our stuff. So I'm George Tony. That's Chris. Is this,
yep.
It's Ty Plum. And, I did this my 41st year in education. I looked around the room at 40 plus college, and it was a little bigger than I thought it would be. This is kind of nice. It's usually, again, I'm very painful because I'm in the room. And I'm going to give a little history in terms of evaluation. This is my 41 years, and I'm going to give you some stuff.
Yeah, Chris Plum. So just like Nick said and George said, I've been an administrator at all levels, a teacher at public, private, and charter public schools, started schools around the Detroit area and now across a couple of states. So we're really excited to be here. And also, we wanted to say this about Dr. Arnold and his presentation. So much of what he was saying, I think, was such a great setup for what we need to talk about in terms of evaluating our teachers and practices support. Number one, how he lifted up a whole change piece. And that change is critical, but hard, and hard to work. But we're in the midst of change now. This is why the construction moment's up here. Number two, to push. Pushing our thinking, pushing our teams. And lastly, the importance of that adult in our life. We lifted up the example of the two adults in this life who are pivotal. And what we know to be true is the number one indicator of student success is that teacher who's in the room with our kids. So it's so really a great setup for us, so I appreciate how far as what he had to say. So we're happy to be here today as separate.
So I want to talk a little bit about change. We had that up there on the screen, but I don't know, things have changed. One change was when in the 50s, you might even get your tenants with security issues for this past year, but those of you that remember that. Community management is a real math problem. It's not something you want to go to school with. Secondly, my first teaching job, I'm there right now, I put myself there right now, my first evaluation. Okay, evaluations certainly put us on alert, make us nervous. And I remember that principal coming in, I remember the fog state. But I first remember him saying to me, so what do you want me to put in? And I said, well, you know, you should go come in anytime you want, foolish. And so I was making, you know, $7,000 a year. So this is a long time ago. Some of you know what that meant. To actually start a job for $7,000 a year as a teacher and being really pleased while I made that first job. So the first evaluation was in April of that year. So yeah, he fell asleep, you're part of it, checked the thermometer, you know, kind of walked out. The other thing I hold out. And I have other stories like that, I won't tell them all. So I'll go meet with him afterwards. And he says, I don't want to use the raw audio or visual aid. Okay? And wait, that's good. Okay. That was my evaluation. Now, I had evaluations that the person never even was there. They sat down with them and they read through this evaluation checklist. So then fast forward to doing my own evaluations as an administrator. And so here's a change, right? Back then, that was probably, I think the 40 plus club in the room could speak to that was their first event. Something similar stories, that was their first event. Where it was the biggest, greatest non-event in their career. This pipe on the ocean.
Yeah, it is.
We're being measured, we're always nervous, right? That first day you go to school, you're being measured. It makes us nervous. And so that first evaluation. So fast forward to when I'm doing evaluations, and first it stuck in my mind, and first, but also the ones where the person is never there, that this whole litany of things that I was or wasn't. And then again, one of the things you want to do is make sure relationships, not talking about relationships. You have a relationship, you can do these things and do them to be effective.
Effectively give feedback
and effectively give evidence, right? So fast forward to my own first ones where I'm making the teacher crazy with long narratives and talking about all the nuances of all the things that are happening in the classroom. So there's a lot of change. The complexity of evaluations today is so much more than what those of us who started this profession 4 decades ago experienced. And what was under us and what we did even 20 years ago, what I was doing as an administrator. And I had an administrator at every level, so it's kind of interesting to me. Even evaluation of high school teachers versus elementary teachers. The elementary teachers are still proud of doing the evaluation, but you know, high school teachers are a lot more than they've done. And we've done here yet. So it is a different experience. What we did, and it's pretty hard to differentiate instruction in this room, there's probably a great way in place. These people were probably pretty experienced in giving evaluations, or certainly experienced at doing evaluation. And I see people that are probably in the first two, third year where they're still trying to get this whole thing down. What we tried to do is find a sweet spot to give you nuts and bolts, but you give an opportunity. We'd like to give an opportunity to those who have brought an experience if they need to ask more nuanced or complicated questions, do it with time at some point today or tonight even, post-event. So bear with us, those of you with a lot of experience. Full disclosure, we were trying to come somewhere in the middle of this presentation. So we'll speak to, this will speak to the state, the compliance kind of side of things. We'll then speak to what should inform your evaluation, and finish with what kind of the overall summary of what evaluation should be about. So in turn, Chris, you can state that.
Yep, so George just basically ran down the presentation objectives today. When we talked to Nick, he had reached out to us. He said a lot of the data that he was getting from administrators and folks in the field of schools was, hey, can you guys sort of demystify this a little bit? We know there's all this change happening at the state. Can you kind of pull it together for us? Can you help us a little bit with some of the why and then some of the how? So that's what we're attempting to try to do here today. So we want you to make sure that you understand so what the current legislation is and what that landscape looks like and then George is going to talk about what we need to be looking at that informs our evaluation process. Understanding the importance of maintaining an aligned evaluation system. We're going to get into this report. And then lastly, we'll walk you through a process that we use. Hopefully you can go back to your school and utilize for yourself. So first of all, it's a construction metaphor. Why the construction metaphor like our gap? It's interesting. We were just doing the talent acquisition process for a school in North Carolina. So we were interviewing hundreds of teachers and administrators for a brand new school. Like a lot of your schools, it's a startup school, it's coming online. We're interviewing a lot of people that have never worked in that kind of environment before. And so as we're interviewing administrators, they're saying, oh, you know, it's sort of a standard response. Well, I don't know. The administrators have to wear many hats. We have to be a counselor. We have to be a friend. We have to be almost like that parent. We have to be a nurse. And what we have to do is the additional hat we need to wear is a hard hat. Because you are literally in a construction zone. Your program is new and you're building this up. Your school, almost literally and figuratively, is new and you're building this from the ground up. So you as administrators, as building leaders, and as even as teachers are part of an ongoing process of evaluation that is literally being built. Right? It's important for you to understand that at the state level, the teacher evaluation process is under construction. Ergo, it's under construction in your business as well. I know that So, let's start off, first of all, with teacher evaluation. Let's just hear from you guys. So, why do we evaluate teachers? Why teacher evaluation? Why do we do this? Anybody? Nice slide. To give feedback to teachers. Okay, so we evaluate teachers, we give feedback to teachers. What else? How else are we evaluating teachers?
You should also say for improvement.
Oh, for improvement. No, continuous improvement. What else?
Increasing achievement.
So we're evaluating teachers to increase the achievement. Okay. Anything else? The number of times you need to evaluate a teacher in a year, the the effectiveness rating categories for those teachers, right? How you can use data, where you're going to use it. So, just recently, there's some current legislation that's just passed. It's an update to that legislation of 2010. We've handed that out to everyone, so we want to make sure that you take that. If you didn't get a copy, there are more being made. We're going to talk about this in a little bit. But the council recommendation went to the state. The state approved those recommendations and is now working on implementation law, which is where rubber meets the road for you in your goal. We're going to talk about it. So that's the current state of law. Like I said, we have on your table, if you will, public acts 257. Okay, what that law is saying must include these things. You must evaluate teacher performance annually with constructive feedback. Right? So just checking the box, just going in with an evaluation system. Yep, I looked at that teacher, I looked at that teacher, this is a you know, he had somebody that came in, looked at his room, washed it, napkin, checked the box, and he was done. There's a constructive feedback on that. Remember, the push is not just to measure what you see happening, but you want to develop teachers, so it has to be constructive feedback. You must establish an approach to measure student growth using relevant data. Relevant, I'm kind of putting in these little quotes because what was relevant a couple of years ago is not necessarily relevant today. It may change in 2015-16 when the state agrees on what the assessment model is going to be. This is important. We're going to talk about that change coming up. Also, in the books, this is current law, your evaluation system, whatever your tool is that you're using, must have these four rating criteria elements to it. They must, by law. You must rate your teachers as either highly effective, effective, minimally effective, or ineffective. Okay? Now, on your table, if you don't have it yet, you will before you leave here, Public Act 257. This is the most hot off the press legislation that can be found on this right now.
Maybe hot off the press 10 years from now, too.
We can't speak to that.
Full disclosure.
But it might be. But as of June 30th, I believe, 2014, this is the law on the book. We made a copy of this. I'm really nice paper, too, 32 pounds. Just so that you have it and can keep it near. Very important for you to understand and be aware of what's in here. What we want to do is give you the most updated legislation and also lift up the important parts. So this is 2015-16. Yes, it's not 2014-15, but the implication is this is your development year. So we want to encourage you to take this year to understand the law, build up your team, and start getting ready for your 15-16 law.
2014-15 is 40%.
Yeah, in terms of data. So, 15-16 still says at least one annual year-end eval. Okay? Look at the change in data. So if you were around when I was a CAO in 2010, and I saw the law saying a significant portion of your evaluation system must be based on student data, a sufficient, significant amount. They didn't give you enough. But what they did is they projected out. And they said, by 13-14, it has to be this. By 14-15, it has to be 40%. And by 15-16, it has to be what?
50%. And by 12-15, 69% of schools had 20%.
50%. That's significant. Raise your hand right now if in your school or in your building you use data 50% in terms of your evaluation system.
Didn't expect to see
it. Two. How about 40%? Raise your hand. 30%. About 30. About 20. When we started in 2010, we started with 20. You know, there was more latitude then. So two of you in this room. 2015-16, everybody, it's 50%. So some of what we're going to talk about today, and what Dr. Arnold did an amazing job of sort of teaming up for us, is change. Right? Managing that change, working with your people through that change, this is significant, 50%. Also, this assessment tool and observation tool, there are assessment tool and observation tools recommendations that were made in the law by the Educator Effectiveness Council. So raise your hand right now if your tool, the tool that you use, the evaluation tool you use, is based on the Danielson framework. About a third of the room, maybe. What about Marzano? Marzano's not. Okay, interesting. What about somebody else like Cottrell? Raise your hand. Okay, raise your hand if you're using something other than those. Okay, so in that legislation, it's important for you to know.
It could be generating Chrome, by the way. Not just using a tool that's out there.
And in the law, it says that that's okay, given that you meet the other critical indicators in that law. Just so you're aware, the council made a recommendation to legislation saying, hey, we endorse these four models or so. And I just sort of ran through them. If you look at the data in the state, they did a follow-up evaluation of, okay, now let's look. 2012, 2013, 13, 14, what are people using out there?
Right.
The majority of the schools that they reviewed and that received feedback from are using the Danielson model. So I'm just letting you know that. The state is not collecting that data for nothing. They want to see what people are using based on the recommendations from the state. Because guess what? The state is going to tell us. The day is coming. The state is going to tell us what tool we need to use. Okay? So they're looking at the recommendations, and then they're looking at what people are using. It's coming. And it's going to be one of those four. Okay, so here are some of the 15-16 mid-year progress reports. This is something else that's a little different. For your beginning teachers and any of your teachers that have been rated ineffective, you need to have on record a mid-year progress report for those teachers. That means you're doing at least a mid-year eval. And you're also creating what are called IDPs for your teachers. And IDPs are what? Individual development plans. Right? And so, which for me, when I'm leading a building or when I'm in a district, I want IDPs for all my teachers, not just those who are struggling. All of your teachers should be identifying their goals and developing their learning and developing throughout each year to improve their practice. But it's on the books now. So make sure you're aware of that. It's also in Public Act 257, which you're going to be aware of. So that's sort of the broad brush landscape of where we are. 257 gives you all the details. 15-16 is where rubber is going to meet the road with some of these new requirements. This year is your construction year. So now what George is going to talk about is, so now you're in the space and you're a leader. You've got this law. You've got maybe a tool that you're using. You're going into rooms. He's going to talk to us about the law.
Before that, are there any questions about the law and this whole kind of straightforward?
This is kind of your insight on. So the scorecard, you know, is heavily based on standard identity emails, part of that, whatever.
High stakes, standardized tests.
Right. and so that's your scorecard, right? And then we have our teacher evaluation system that's got to be 50%.
The teacher development side of it. Right. About, so there's the student growth side, let's call it what it is, and then there's the teacher development side.
So 50% of the teacher evaluation has to be based on student achievement, relevant achievement.
Human growth.
Right. So, but it doesn't say what assessment you have to use.
Exactly.
So, the profile assessment that the R&D behind the assessment is correlated to your standardized test.
Aligned, I think, is the term they use.
But that's still arguing. I mean, I know a lot of people still argue that.
Yep.
So, right. So, you got meet or take standardized tests that's made in your existence, if you will.
Correct.
And then you've got your growth model over here that's measured because we leeway helping out our scan chart scores. So you're pulling two different ways. Am I making sense?
You are. All right. And so, and then, so the, that 50%, that assessment system, Richard, if you're using some sort of a growth model assessment in your building right now, like performance series, raise your hand if you're using the NWEA map. Okay, and these are both assessments.
So the authorizer doesn't require one. Is that it? The same authorizer, pardon?
Yes.
Yeah, so either one you can, okay.
Either one.
It's good to know.
Either one, right. Okay, so the question over here was, okay, so how are we getting our head around what that assessment data needs to look like? And that's a terrific question. Right now, that's one of those gray areas where they're not putting in black and white in the law what your assessment system needs to be. They're saying that it needs to show growth, it needs to be aligned. And part of the reason why they're not putting that into the law just yet is because they don't know it just yet.
But here's what you're going to have, Chris. We're going to have this year. I'm forecasting, we're almost done with our scan time.
Yep.
If we're going to have a lot of highly effective teachers, yet our proficiency rate, because our effectiveness is based on growth of students to be a scan time, yet our proficiency rate on the mean is low. We're 80% for your dislodge, everything comes with rural Michigan. So you're going to see people are going to be process, they don't understand.
You're right. And are you going to run down in the, like they all did through the forest, figuring this out and leave your face print on a tree? Yeah. Yes. Yes, you are. Yes, you are. Here's a recommendation. I spoke with some folks in the governor's office about exactly this. And what they said was, listen, if your schools are using performance series or NWEA map right now, have them do that in 14-15. Base your evaluation on a tool like that you are using. Yes, the MEAP is coming back, but if you recall, they shut the MEAP office down, right? We're all family here. We're all family. And I know some folks in that office, so I know what things are like, but we're, you know, let's just keep this in house. 2 years ago, they really sort of shut that machine down in favor of what? Smarter Balance. You couldn't go anywhere without reading Smarter Balance somewhere. Am I right? Smarter Balance, Smarter Balance. Who's been hearing so much about Smarter Balance lately?
It's kind of fallen off
the map. It kind of has. You know why? Because the decision has not been made on whether they're going to use Smarter Balance now or some of the other assessment companies that are working real hard to get the state to use their tool. And I'm just being transparent and being honest, and I'm being real about this. But if you think about it, the assessment organizations, right, that are have been hearing that, oh, there are these other assessments, performance series, NWEA math, that are saying there are correlations in student outcomes in their tests with our ACT, well, we should be in that game. Right? I mean, I'm just saying, this is in the room. State has not made that decision. But they will. They will. This is what's really important. Right now, the fact that you guys are using PST and NWEA is right on target. And I would look at both your proficiency, the target, the fact that your teachers are actually getting this to hit the target, and your growth. Because they're all using this triannually, I think. They're doing a fall, winter, spring, right? Use that. But beware, it's in 257 that you're going to leave with here today. It says in there in black and white that the assessment model that we will be moving to is one of the states choosing. So that's coming. Think about this year, you're not going to stop getting the NWEA and the PST because it shows you college readiness and it shows you growth. But that assessment is coming from the state. But as you're in construction and you're building your evaluation system, use the tools that you have. We have NWEA and that, and we have an authorizer that sees the value in that sort of growth assessment. Use that.
What strategies
going back real quick, Council on Educator Effectiveness made a recommendation in this regard.
They knew you're going to have teachers that don't teach for or not in areas. What are we going to do for them? Their recommendation was, hey, allow schools to utilize an assessment of something other than the four core for those teachers. I think we're some years away from getting to that, right? So what do you do? And the reason why I'm saying this is a longer conversation is we would need to work with your school on what a school as a whole model would work for you, right? You need a school as a whole model, which means even though your music teachers and PE teachers are teaching math and ELA, we want to give them credit for working with kids on literacy and math. And they see all the, most of our specialty teachers see all the kids in our building. And they're part of our PLCs. And they're part of, they're involved in it. So they should have credit. And if you look at your overall growth, you look at averages of the kids that they're seeing, you can create what's called a school as a whole model.
And we probably have a propensity to give long answers. The short answer is, when you weigh, you're going to weigh the school by this kind of percentage. There's just, there's no getting away from it. You're going to weigh the school by percentage. That sort of covers your life. You really don't have, they're not in the same cauldron that the ELA and math people are. Let's face it. I mean, it's just moving around. So you'll have this weighting. You'll figure out your weighting when you do that. So I, for the sake of time, because there's not a lot left, we've got a lot to cover. Run over a little bit, say no, they won't be good with that now, or we might run over a little bit. Is that all right?
Right.
So, in terms of quality evaluation, we looked at the research. Obviously, Danielson and Marzano and McCrell and Reeves have done all this work for us, but we also used a gentleman named Hattie, and who's got your alternative meta-analyses, use of meta-analyses. How they arrive at effect sizes, and an effect size being more percentage of effect sizes. An effect size, and we'll get there at some point, we'll look at a little handy stuff. 0.5 or below, 0.4 or below, 0.5 or below is really minimal effect size. 0.5 and above gets you anywhere up to 50% effect. Right? So that anything that's 0.5 and above, the meta-analyses that Hattie did were 800 of them, roughly. Approximately 2 million students, so it's pretty extensive stuff. It's probably the most exhaustive research that we have. So we tend to use that. So we're looking at what works ultimately. So your teachers, these are kinds of things you should think about in terms of evaluations and the things that you should be looking for. Your teachers should be interacting with an aligned and rigorous curriculum. Part of that's your responsibility as a building or as a district. The other part is that they need to be aligned in working with that. Effective instruction. So we'll very quickly look at the strategies that are and what works. Please, Hattie and Marzano. We've done meta-analyses, and if it's good enough for science, it should be good enough for us in the meta-analysis process. I won't go through how you arrive at the formula. Use the formative assessment, student assessment data. So formative and summative assessment, multiple data. The point here, your teacher should be using multiple data points. Not one, not two. They should be pre- and post-testing. Positive school classroom culture focused on achievement. Culture of achievement. So everybody thinks effective instruction, just do the strategies. No, culture of achievement is a larger picture. You need to decide what that is. You need to work at that. What is the culture of the building, and is it a culture of achievement? And it doesn't mean simply that we're testing and retesting and testing and testing and testing and testing. It means that we do some of the things that work. And Hattie shows us some of the things that work. In person community engagement and such contact. Now, is that part of your evaluation? No. Should it be part of your conversation with teachers? Yes, in terms of the evaluation process. You should know that this has happened, okay? There was a time that this didn't. There was a time that this didn't happen, and now it's happened. Like my day, and I tried to explain to you, at $7,000 a year, I didn't have to talk to the parent if I didn't want to. If you're looking for evidence of these things in instruction, prioritize slash power standards. Okay? Those lesson plans should reflect prioritize standards. Your teacher should be able to unwrap standards. Okay? And if you don't know what that means, simply raise your hand and I'll I'll try to give a short answer. Yeah, I'm going to say this. Unit development, got to be there. You got to see evidence of it. Not judgment, evidence. Remember Danielson's big thing, it's true. There's a lot of judging that goes on. And then there's evidence. Use evidence. Curriculum mapping and aligned curriculum, again, that's important. So if somebody's teaching, well, you know, I really tell good stories about Jeffersonian democracy. Well, that's nice. But really, truly, what are the standards that you're addressing and how are you assessing for mastery? You have to see evidence of this stuff in these evaluations, right? So keep it around. I'm going to go through a lot of stuff, a lot of information. I'll try to get some time. Assessments. Common assessments. Everybody should know what those are. Formative and summative common assessments. Your PLCs, I use that as a generic term. It could be data teams. It could be, there's all kinds of versions. Smoker has a version. Langenstein has a version. Lazard has a version. Those of us who've been around a long time have seen all these folks. Dufour is kind of focused on PLCs. I call PLCs the conversations you have. There's different structures and approaches. Pre and post test, you've got to know where they start and where they finish. The guy had more than one data point isn't enough. End of the year summative evaluation is not enough for our teachers. Performance series test or some other NWMAC, some other kind of aligned test. Performance series might be 3 times a year. Got 3 data points on a highly reliable and valid standardized test. Other reliability and validity that made this hard because it's a metric-driven kind of culture and state. And so we tend to gravitate to these reliable and valid tests. So we tend to give them a Monday high stakes, you know, snapshot tests. That's why we really want our teachers doing multiple data points. We really want to show growth and trajectory over the year. We also want to project it not to be this or this. To be in the open. There'll be a map, ACT plan of score, and whatever ACT ends up lobbying for, we'll get because they bring all this money and they spread it around Lansing, and we'll probably end up with ACT Spire or whatever. So, research of what works. 0.78 effect size and feedback. Probably a little bit. Teacher student relationships. Dr. Brown talked about relationships. This relationship is manifest. Teacher-student relationships. By the way, you need to attend to mastery learning. What does mastery learning look like? What's proficient? What's percentages? I mean, is 4 out of 5 and 5 and 20 different standards? Is 4 out of 5 and each 5 is broken up in a unit, let's say? Is that mastery? No, 20% not getting done at the end of that unit, at the end of that semester. It's not mastery. So really understanding what mastery looks like, okay? Sorry to have to go fast when you don't want to. Marcello's nice strategies are as good as anything. Look for evidence of these. Know what these look like first, and then look for evidence of these. And I used to go in with a checklist of these and other checklists, and I was jotting down notes in each of these areas where I saw evidence of these strategies. Because the meta-analyses that Marzano did show that these strategies work. If you don't look at this, the research, if you're not seeing teachers implementing and using the research, we know the research will move the needle. We do know that because of these, it shows us this. If you don't see evidence of this, the likelihood of moving the needle and getting yourself into trouble as a school is moving the needle likelihood is low. Getting yourself in trouble as a school. Sorry, much. This is what adding, I mean, usually we do an exercise where we throw a bunch of these items and you say, drag those, and then we show you what the meta-analysis is. Feedback, 0.73 effect size, okay? So again, remember, anything from here below, might as well throw off. Those are losers. Notice homework. Okay, what does every parent, or most parents say? Well, you know, Johnny doesn't have enough homework. Yeah, well, there's a reason. It doesn't have a high effect size. Okay. Feedback. We'll talk a little bit about that. Teacher-student relationships. Shade of goal feedback. Mastery learning. So what do we identify as top 3? Look at the research. You say, oh, this is where it's at.
I've got it.
I think I have electronically visible learning PowerPoint on it. I may have a hard copy here. prepared to give any comments for you. I'll leave it. Peer tutoring, so challenge of goals, peer tutoring, there's still decent effect size. It's somewhere, you know, between 25 and 15 and 40%. These are 50% above the impact. The effect. So, the most powerful single influence enhancing achievement is feedback. Quality feedback is needed, not more feedback. All right, so, I started teaching, and some of us in here started teaching, what was feedback?
A, B, C, D,
and all the D's ones. So feedback is a great, is a letter grade. How many times did you give back a paper, those of us are a little older, or did you get them in college? You might have gotten a couple of notes, like, this is really bad writing, you know, and you're, okay, it was, that's the reality of it. The reality is that times have changed. Feedback has got to be qualitative kind of feedback. It's got to be important. Oral feedback is much more effective than written. Why do you think that is? I'm going to talk in the action. I'm sorry for that. Why do you think oral feedback is more important than written feedback?
Personal.
Yeah, relationship.
I can't ask this particular question.
Needs more detail.
About what? You can't ask a paper question without, in written feedback. It's not bad, and it sometimes makes up for the deficiency. It's not an outcome. Well, powerful feedback is provided from the students and the teacher. Now, let's move this over to evaluation. So where do you think the most powerful feedback is going to be? In this case, from student to teacher, what do you think it's going to be when you're doing the evaluation?
From teacher to you.
Powerful feedback to be from teacher to you. So you learn how to elicit,
and we teach folks how to ask those kinds of questions. A good degree, those of us who have been, I spent some time out with Pound and in adventure education in the 70s.
And you learned about, Dewey's model, to brief, to do the activity, and then to debrief. And what I found over the years, that's the briefing questions, but sentence points.
Because if you're asking a question, somebody can give you a yes or no answer. We're probably going to tell you how the book's written, but they'll probably give you a yes or no answer.
And then that's not good feedback from the student. You're not eliciting good feedback from the student. And if the student is a teacher,
and by the way, the last building I started, I hired all fresh out. I had to raise these kids.
Work that's old and all, not combined. And I had to raise them, but it was great because they were so smart. They were all smarter than I was. And they all completely did me in, and I couldn't format a memo, let alone, in terms of computers, so I always had a lot of help on it. But it was interesting to do evaluations with fresh eyes. It was interesting to talk about things that they did more in their teacher preparation. You're still getting those teachers, by the way. Chris and I started a teacher preparation program at the University of Michigan Flint. And we did it because we were tired of reteaching teachers. We were tired of telling them, I'm learning this. I'll put it over here. Because when you get into an urban school, these are the things you're going to encounter. They say, what? What are you talking about? And I formulated a statement, you ain't teaching you. Everybody goes into a classroom thinking the ideal is that. I said, you ain't teaching me. And they used to get irritated about that. And I said, I tell you, that's probably the most powerful thing I can tell you. Because we all go in wanting them to be, we all go in wanting our high school experience. We all go in wanting those students to be, there's an ideal that we have. There are standards, somebody mentioned standards that we have. Guess what? They come as this goo and there's all this mess where you're trying to get them to be like you. So we begin to have teachers wrestle. Relationships will grow when teachers wrestle with what's inside of them first. The biases and the racism and the sexism that they bring into that room every day. I don't ask them to be colorblind, to be what they call objective. I ask them to wrestle with what's inside of them every day so that they can then know that we're all flawed and that we all have to struggle with this stuff. And I know we're struggling. And so in an interview, I'll ask that question.
So what does it look like? What is this, what do you think it feels like to be the only person that looks like you on that board? And they say, oh, I'm probably blind. Oh, no problem. I'm say, then you're blind. You're deaf, dumb, and blind. Because there is a difference, and to acknowledge that difference internally, and to work with it, wrestle with it, work through it. So that's where the work is done. It isn't done by trying to make everybody something that they're not. And so it's one student at a time, it's understanding the students. That's how relationships grow. So, master learning. I had that as well as three big. All children can learn when they focus on mastery, casting a collaborative environment, focus learning conditions, and classroom include. High levels of cooperation between classrooms. Focus, and by the way, cooperative learning isn't built high on Hattie's research, but cooperation between classmates is high because relationships is high, right? Focus teacher feedback that is both frequent and diagnostic. Both frequent and diagnostic. Not the grade, but frequent and oral. Right? And then, variable time allows to reach levels of attainment. So really a fancy way of staying scaffold. It's really a fancy way. You need to see evidence of these things. And I'm going to tell you, I used to write this book, this roll through the check as part of the evaluation. So now let's get to the computer stuff. Or there was a commercial, there's the beef. Let's get to the beef. The beef was my narrative, what I saw, the evidence of the things that I saw and that I was looking for. Now, another recommendation that's not up here that I would make is that you work with teachers to have common language, vocabulary, and understanding of what it is you're going to be looking for. It's so important that you articulate the things that I'm going to be looking for. So in that pre-observation meeting, and Chris will go through the alignment of a protocol and process, in that pre-observation meeting, you want to be clear on the language, vocabulary, and understanding between what you're going to be looking for. That's the only, it's only fair to them. It's only fair to them. And you want to see scaffold because that's differentiated, that's all part of differentiated instruction. That's very, very important. If you're seeing one size fits all, you're going to get the results we've always been getting. Do what we've always done and we'll get the results we've always got. Any questions so far? I'm sorry, I'm going to move fast. I feel bad. Yeah. Teacher student relationships. It's tricky. How do you know when you're going to class, you're sitting in the back of the class, you got all your, you're coming with your goals or you're coming with your pad of paper. How do you know when you see it? That's a question. What's evidence of a teacher student relationship? That's strong.
Engagement.
Engagement? Okay, absolutely. Engagement is one of the great signs.
When students feel comfortable asking for assistance or help.
So when you get a sense that students know it's an emotionally and physically safe place to be, right? Yes, that's true. Anybody else?
So at our school, when students are following their social construct, when teachers are engaging care, all those kinds of things.
So there's some evidence there. Yes. Social contract, which is a common language, a common vocabulary that everybody understands, and you start to see this. You see that student starts to get up because they got an itch and they want to scratch it and say, ah, where is my hand? When you start to see that, you know that the relationships in that room are strong. When you start to see the way students treat each other, you know relationships are part of the culture of that room. We also teach building culture in the classroom. Leadership, and McCrell, we both have a whole section on leadership. And, you know, Danielson, Marzano will call other things, but it's really seeing culture in the classroom.
And, well, so you give an example that I won't. My screen, for example.
How I did this is you.
Yeah. So, any questions on what we're trying to start? Any questions? I love how Zach was so
good. Well, and here's the reality, too. It's like, know your room, know the vibe in the room. Right? The vibe in the room right now is you've been getting a lot of beta spit at you, it's mid-morning, you know, we had this real upswing with Dr. Arnold, and we had a break, and now we're sort of easing into this, and so I understand that, and I think what I really want to make sure that we connect with you, because maybe some of you are asking, well, why would they spend so much time on the why of teacher evaluations when we came here, we wanted to know the what. Just tell us what to do. I'm a building leader, tell me what the law is, tell me what to do. Because at the end of the day, you need to move the needle on your student achievement in your building, period. It's not going to be at the end of the day if shut the light out in the building and say, yeah, but you know what, I had this robust teacher evaluation tool. It won't matter. It won't matter. Lake Superior State University wants to know that you're growing students, you're getting student achievement marks. They want to know that you're a fiscally sound building, they want to know that all your compliance T's are crossed and I's are dotted. That's what they want to know. We're talking today about teacher evaluation and what should inform teacher evaluation in your building. You're holding your teachers accountable for these things that we have up there that you know work. Period. If you're walking around with a teacher evaluation tool and your teachers aren't doing these things, you're not going to get student achievement in the job. Period. So it's very important that you guys make this connection. So the what and the why we've covered. So now how do you go about doing this? The first thing is that we want to make sure that you're leaving here with this mental set that you're not just going out there to figure out the best way to measure your teachers. Please understand. Right? You've got to leave here with an understanding that, yeah, you're going to have a measurement, but you're here, your job is to help develop your teachers. Your evaluation process should be developing your teachers toward a culture of high achievement. Right? You must make that determination. Then when you're going back, you need to communicate this vision. That in our evaluation process, we're going to be working together to both measure and develop the staff in this building to move the needle on the scores. And I need everybody in here with me. Here's the law. Here's the what. We're not changing that. Right? But maybe how we do this, we're going to do together. And my job is to hold us responsible for what we know works. Right? Communicate that. Select that evaluation tool. State says use one of four. We're not here to endorse any one. We just said Danielson number one because the data plays out over the last 2 years. Hey, guess what? Most of your colleagues across the state are using Danielson.
Of the 1,400 schools that were surveyed, 688 chose Danielson. The next one, too, is Marzano, 180 something. I forget the number. But it's over 20%.
And here's something that you should know in this year. Now, the state, right, they have the right at any point when they come out of committee, because this is in committee right now, they can come out and say, guess what? Look proud. That's what you're going to use. And you should put all your eggs in the Danielson basket. I understand that. We're at their mercy with that. But for you going into this year, 14, 15, to help you, hey, the quickest way to get from A to B, if you choose a tool like Danielson. Danielson already has. You go to four domains. If you don't know Danielson, make a note, look up four domains. And four measurement criteria. So it works out pretty well. If you lay what the state says about minimally effective, ineffective, effective, or highly effective over Danielson's rubric, it works. So we want to make that suggestion to you. It's a good bet. So if you're going back to your team and saying, look, 2014-15, we're going to move to a Danielson model, here's what the law says, and here's how we're going to do it, we're going to do it together. Identify your performance data source. The point came over here, wow, well, what sort of data are we supposed to use? We know that the state's going to come tell us what we're going to be using, but right now there's some gray area out there. It's out there. Let's take advantage of the fact that Lake Superior is saying you need to have PST or NWEA. Use that. Are you growing kids? And maybe that's of that 50%. Maybe 50% of that 50, if you're with me, mid-morning, is are we growing? And the other 50% is who hit our targets. Simple as that. Make it simple and use the data that you have. Let me say that again. Because some people are like, ooh, I wonder what they have for lunch. I understand. Half of that 50% growth. On average, are you growing your kids in your room? Now let's look at the other 25% being your kids hitting the targets in this room. Make it simple on yourself. That other 50% of your evaluation system is your observation tool. And if you use Danielson, again, a good bet, you've got your performance figures. See how that works? This is a big one. Now, this is a place where a lot of schools aren't yet. But a lot of schools that George and I and our outfit, GPS, we go into, schools have an educational program. Everybody in this room, because you submitted an application in the English school, you have an ed program. For some of you, that ed program is more alive and visible than for others. We go into some schools and they're like, hey, you need to help us with our data. You need to help us with this. We always start with, okay, show us your ed program. And they're like, you know, they blow the dust off sometimes. Like, well, here, this is all our hands, I'm going to have. But then, you know what, this is the reality. Some of the work we do, and the recommendation we would make, is go look at your ed program and make sure that your evaluation system aligns to that ed program. If you're talking in your ed program about things that you're doing in your school, put that in your tool. Hold your teachers accountable for what your chart says.
And to add to that, if you're customizing an evaluation, it's fine, it's great, because that's what I would do now. It's done for you. You know, it's great because your ed plan, you can adapt your ed plan and change it, amend it such that they line up, that there's a direct line from the ed plan to the evaluation. That's the advantage of customizing.
Yeah, so we just want to make sure that when you're working with your team and you're rolling out your evaluation system, if you're going to use the Danielson model, if you're going to use that data, make sure that then your lesson plan is aligned to that and your walkthrough protocol is aligned to that. You're going to put this out to your teachers. Make sure that what they're giving to you in terms of their lesson plans is aligned. When you go through, make sure you're seeing evidence of those things that you're going to evaluate your teachers on.
Common understand, common vocabulary.
Right off the rip, when you get back, establish this calendar with your staff. Here's what we're doing for 14-15 with evaluation. Here's our schedule. Here's where I'm coming. I'm going to be checking in with you X amount of times because I know the research says feedback is the most important indicator of growth. I'm going to be checking in with you. Here's the schedule. I'm going to be walking through. Here's the schedule. My job is to not come in here and just measure you. My job is to hold you and the rest of us accountable to both say the same thing to move the needle on. Make sure that you're creating these individual plans with teachers. I don't know if you need a format, a goal chart for your teachers. Just let us know. Shoot us an email. Stop us. We can help you with this. Some of you may already have it. But when you're doing those check-ins, real clear goals based on the evidence. Okay? Oh, and that thing I want to make sure that this is, I'm lifting this up too, is all of this work that you're doing, do with your teachers, not to them or for them. Listen to that. Do this work, this evaluation system work, because immediately out of the gate, when you talk about evaluation system with teachers, what happens? They freak out. The neuroscientists would say they go on alert. Their amygdala fires up, the same part of the brain that fired up, you know, when saber-tooth tigers used to run after us. So I'm telling you, it'll fire up. Take them off alert. Let them know right away that we're doing this with you. We're going to be doing this with you, not to you, before.
For feedback from the teacher is important as the teacher listening to feedback from the student. Or for learning.
Right. Then this last bit is, because I know what it's like, the course knows what it's like, to be you, the administrator in that building, this is overwhelming. You know, embrace it and jump. Launch now. 15-16 is going to be happening, and guess what? A lot of things are going to be happening to us in 15-16. Look at that law. Launch. Take advantage of this opportunity this year to build your framework, build your system, communicate the why, and then work with your staff on how. Do it.
And I would hammer out 50% now. Why wait for 40% in 2014, 2015, it's 50% in 2015, 2016. I wouldn't wait for the 10%. And that's on that recommendation.
Yeah, I mean, the teachers are already on board. If we're putting them on alert with an evaluation system, 40% of that is based on data, and then next year you come around this time next year and say, oh, guess what? Even more of the evaluation system is based on data now. Start with 50. It's our recommendation.
And especially if you're customizing, don't be afraid to do fragmented lines with the teachers.
As you're working through this, the end of the year, pull that team back together. How are you doing? How did you do? How did you feel through this process? How did you work with them, not to them or for them?
We sprayed a lot of data at you.
Our goal in coming in today was to give you the what, where are we in the current state of the law, you're leaving with the current state of the law. So why are we evaluating? We're not just evaluating to measure our teachers because our ship could be sinking while we have the best evaluations in the whole planet. We're evaluating our teachers to get student outcomes. Right? Now how it's going to be used with our teachers instead of to them.
Any questions? I know we're tight on time, just have a thought at this point. Any questions about any of it?
Yes.
Can you speak to us more about the, can you go over an ACT to be from its floor plan to the Spire? Maybe we can talk later.
That's how his lobbying money's been spent, they don't know yet. They're certainly lobbying heavily for that. ACT is probably renting an office space in that sense.
So have they eliminated this floor plan?
Well, the floor plan is still an option to use.
Oh, it is?
No, until the state makes a decision, that guy wants to.
I would stay with this floor plan, by the way, until the state says.
You can't,
You know, we obviously don't want to comment too much on what ACT is doing or what they're, or what even what.
I don't want to comment too much more.
Yeah, I probably didn't. I'm not really quite sure. That may be an indicator that the state's moving in a specific direction. I can't really speak to that.
Okay.
Any other questions? But I mean, somewhat, ACT, it's kind of funny. Our students, we want them to worry about anything. We're college going, the last high school I started was at college going. Culture. It's hard to get them to worry about anything. ACT, because we hammered ACT, we really went at ACT. So it's really hard to, second, third day, to worry about anything that stays sane. So this was an easy answer to stuff, isn't it? You gotta remember at the end of the day, I believe, what's in the best, with the goals of your high school, and what's in the best interest of the student. Well, as I look, colleges don't look past your MME score. They look for your ACT score. How do you help them pick that? So this thing's gonna get worked out and change, obviously. And I will open it for you.
I have a question just about the percentage. You're saying the 50% of the evaluation for your process and then the other 50% for student achievement. The Marzano evaluation, which is what we use, is like this thing.
Yeah.
So then only 50% of the evaluation will be counted using that tool. Are we allowed to scale it down, or is it an all or nothing for the
evaluation? The state hasn't determined the instrument for you. Okay. You can customize, you still can customize. I think this young man Brian, who's working for Dutch Loan.
Yeah.
So there's some experience in the room of customization right here. And I'm not against it at all, I'm for it actually. But
yeah, going back to where it's a beef, your comment that you said, we want real good, constructive, authentic feedback from teachers instead of just checking boxes.
That's right.
And that's why we've customized ours, where we have to move to something different perhaps, but the teachers very much appreciate that more than check boxes.
The culture of your organization is what you just described. It's an example, a reflection of the culture of your organization, which is that we want something that's qualitative feedback, and that is with the teachers, and therefore this exchange of thinking and ideas makes coaching a lot easier.
Every evaluation that we have, we call them observations. It takes the edge off a little bit, but our building leaders then have a follow-up meeting on Friday afternoons with our teachers, 15, 20 minutes just to go over it, because again, the written words is tough, you have questions, and that's how you get your teachers better. We view our building leaders as coaches.
As a superintendent, Brian, you mentioned to me that you do one evaluation for each teacher in your district.
Personally,
right?
Yes.
Did I get that straight?
Yeah.
And so that tells you from top down that everybody's paying attention to, there are superintendents who don't know who the teachers are in their districts. So I'm hearing from one who says I'm doing one evaluation, one observation, on every teacher in the district. I assume you're giving feedback to everyone.
Yeah, and I'll do a follow-up meeting, the same thing, because I need to model for my building leaders what they need to be doing.
That's cultural. So I'm looking it up because I'm impressed with it.
Thank you.
That's really wrapping us up. We have a team at GPS of people who have been in your seat. You know, we've been known leaders, we've been teachers, we've had to wrestle with this stuff, we've been bitten by all the same things you're getting bitten by, and the work we do is to come into the space with you and build these things out, and do these things with you instead of to you or for you as well. Help develop that culture, help you with the why pieces, help you build out your alignment, your protocols. If you need that kind of help, if you seek that help, don't hesitate to reach out to us. Our information is over there on the table. That'll show you some of the other things that we offer in the name of helping our kids succeed. Okay, so thank you all very, very, very much.
Sorry, I'm